We have time, lots of time, I think, because I talk fast when I'm nervous. But yeah, so if that brought anything to the tops of your minds or your hearts, I would love to hear from you. We have another audience mic. Or you can just scream at me, that's fine too. Yeah, go for it.
I just have a question.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure, questions work too.
Well, I was wondering about, like personally, I'm 18 years old and I just recently entered college, and I have a really positive attitude, I'm happy about it, but I also have like existential crises like every day.
Yeah.
You know,
me too.
College stuff.
Yeah.
And
that doesn't stop at the end of college.
Yeah,
sorry.
I've heard that. what I'm wondering is that like a lot of times people give you advice to just be yourself, but I find a lot of times I don't know who I am or like what that means. And so I was wondering what you kind of have to say about how do I be myself on the internet if I don't understand who that is yet.
Be the person who doesn't understand what that is. That's fine too. And I don't know who I am yet. You know, it's easy for us people who sit here at these panel tables, which by the way, my invisible friends here, to be able to, you know, say that we've reached some state of self-actualization where we have, you know, a great clue of who we are. But I think that's a lie. And anyone who tells you that they know who they are 100% is lying, because you change every day of your life. Like every small one of those existential crises changes you for the better, I think. So whilst, yeah, you wouldn't really know who to be, I think you can be every single aspect of yourself at this current time. If you are a massive Doctor Who fan right now, but you will not be in 2 years, that's fine too, you know. I don't like a lot of things that I used to like a couple of years ago. So just be who you are at this current time, as in love the things you love. I think, you know, deep down inside of you, there's a kind person who's lived through life experiences that you will not be able to erase, and that are part of you, your patchwork quilt. If there's a patchwork quilt inside of you, everything that you live through makes a portion of that patchwork quilt. So give to people and give them the portions of that patchwork quilt that you currently feel comfortable with, and those will change. But if they love you, they'll change with you. There's no pressure to know who you are. I don't. And I don't want to, ever.
Thank you.
Yeah, go for it.
Question. So I want to ask you a little bit about your internet friends.
Mm-hmm.
I'm part of a Facebook Nerdfighter group.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And I interact with them. We have some discussion about various nerdy things.
Yeah.
And to me, they're maybe internet acquaintances.
Right.
I never felt like I developed a friendship on the internet. I don't even have an idea of how that's even possible to consider people you've never met your friend.
Fair
how
enough.
Do you cultivate?
Yeah, I'm biased because I met my husband on the internet. literally that cult that I was telling you about. At least I got a husband out of it. But like, yeah, it was like that and five people was just the only thing, because then I had to spend like a year dealing with my mental health. But no, I see exactly what you mean, and I get that a lot. I think private messaging is your answer. Like you can only go so far having conversations with people about the nerdy things that you both enjoy, right? Like as much as you love, I don't know, Vlogbrothers, whatever other show you might watch in common, you can only like talk about that for like 7 hours, and then you kind of need to find out a little bit about each other. So I think just be brave. Like that's the thing that I did when I realized that it was possible to open up this whole avenue of friendship. And I think you have to accept that somewhere first before you can make any internet friends. Like, I had no idea how to make friends. Like, I started my master's and I was like, oh, I've got loads of real life friends from my undergrad. Like, I don't need to make another friend on my master's. Like, I'll just work. And then I realized that, like, how do you make friends in your 20s? Like, you don't exist in a space where friendships are made for you, right? So it's kind of more your responsibility. So online was like this whole new arena. I was like, people though, like, and people who might like me, how exciting. And you're starting off on the good foot, right? Because if you were to meet someone randomly in the middle of nowhere and try to strike up a conversation with them, you have no idea that you have any shared interests, which of course don't need to be the basis of friendship, but it helps. And these people that you have conversations with on this group, like, you know that you're starting from a point of shared interest. And so if you have any desire or want to open your heart to them, like, it's just like any other friendship, except you don't get to hang out on your couch, you get to hang out on Facebook Messenger. And then eventually you get to meet them in real life, which is just like the best experience ever, because you are literally seeing a person for the first time and you already love them. Like, how glorious is that? So I think, yeah, you just have to put yourself out there and believe that they can be your friends, and they will.
Thank you.
Yes. Yeah, scream though. Because you're far away.
I wanted to go back to the person that asked the first question about, like, how to be yourself on the internet.
Mm-hmm.
Shameless, like, Vlogbrothers plug. John has a really good video called Who I Was in High School that I would really recommend you watching. And he just kind of talks about how, like, who he was in high school isn't who he is now, and how you're, like, continuously learning about yourself. So that's a good one to watch. But I feel the same way because I'm, like, about to finish college, and I know early on I was, like, coming out of high school and I was like, I don't really, like, resonate with that me anymore.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, like, where I'm at, I don't know anyone here, and I'm not about to, like, go out of my house and meet strangers in real life. I don't want to do it. So that's where, like, the internet for me really came in. Just, like, scroll through your Tumblr feed, it's like, Instagram and, like, scroll through Twitter, because that's where I just, like, found things and I was like, oh, that was really funny. And then you, like, dive into that, like, hole. Or when you get to, like, the weird section of YouTube. And, like,
yeah, I've been there.
I like
the weird section.
So, like, just going through all the crazy, like, sidetracked things, and then you find, like, oh, I like this, or oh, I like this, or I need to, like, know everything about who you are. And so I would, like, really recommend just wasting a lot of time on, like, scrolling.
I completely agree, yeah. I completely agree. And also, one thing that I would add to that is, be okay, literally stand in front of the mirror and teach yourself to say, I was wrong. Because the most important thing that you can do online and in real life, but online mostly, because the internet, as much as I've hopefully delivered a love letter to it, is a really scary place in that everything you write and everything you are is always on the internet. And we know that, you know, people can dig up tweets from 2006 and be like, hey, you are a racist asshole in 2006. And you're like, it's 2017, I've learned. But you also want to die because, like, you said that thing in 2006. But I think the more that you stand in front of the mirror and tell yourself, I was wrong, that does two things. That, number one, allows you to admit your mistake, which is something that I really struggle to do, and I think most of us, if we were being honest, would really struggle to do, because there's a sense of pride and ownership. But also, it allows you to embrace the fact that you are a changing person and that your interests are going to change, and that maybe you'll have to do that thing of scrolling through explore page on Instagram or Facebook or Tumblr and educate yourself every 2 years if you have to. Like, we should be changing for the rest of our lives, and I think we need to embrace that and accept that, and yeah, stand in the mirror and tell us I was wrong. Yeah.
Well, first of all, the first question reminded me a lot of an analogy that Hank used in Crash Course Philosophy about identity, which is that you are a bunch of chain links put together. Links fall off and links come on. There's always some, like they're always attached. They're always changing. It's impossible to keep track of all of them. But for me, the sense of community and connection that I get isn't so much from YouTube, it's from a place where you put on a username, you write a character, and then you talk. You learn things in there about people that those people probably don't tell their acquaintances or friends. It's painful to leave.
It's true, yeah. Definitely true, and I think you said the thing just then. You said you learn things in there that people probably don't tell their acquaintances and friends, and that is literally what I just spent 20 minutes saying, and why I think the internet is so beautiful. Because hopefully one day, if you're safe and if you're happy to do so, then the internet will give you the strength to continue that narrative into real life and tell your acquaintances and family and friends. But even if you don't, you still have a space where you can say those things unapologetically, even if it is with a username where you're talking to people. So yeah, I completely agree. And also, I love the fact that we're all in a room where like we understand each other's obscure references to videos from like 6 years ago. That makes me really happy. Most of the time I spend my life explaining. So there's these two brothers and they started this thing.
You could do that for me.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
So this is more comment again than a question, but I think it's important to note, and I know we keep coming back to this first question, but I think it's just everyone here has probably experienced that at some point in their lives, and like it really, I think, resonates with most people. But it's important to note that change is, for most people, I won't say for everyone, but for most people, really, really scary. And it's especially when you are in front of people that you know, or people that knew you in the past, or people that you know that you might know in the future or get to know in the future. It's scary to present yourself in a way that maybe you haven't explored yet. And having a forum or a place online where you can, for a while, dissociate to that word, but like separate who you are to people you talk to in person from who you might want to be in the future or who you might want to explore. Like maybe I could be this way, but I don't know if that's what I want. And I don't want to present myself that way to people that might affect, you know, maybe my future opportunities, or I'm scared to do that. So by having like a semi-anonymous figure online, it gives you a place to look into that, explore yourself, find like put on a persona, but see if that persona is what you want to become.
I feel like you could have literally given my talk. Like, you're so eloquent. join me next time. But no, yeah, I completely agree. And that's where the whole genesis of this idea started. And I'm really glad it resonates and people understand. Yeah.
How do you balance the incentives in online, in social networks, and in real life of presenting like an idealized, like pretty perfect, like happy life, and what is real and authentic and who you actually are?
That's a really interesting question, because I like, if we all have daily existential crises, like that's exactly what mine are about. Like I really don't know how to deal with that, because we all know that Facebook especially, and mostly the profiles that are open to like our family and friends, and again, people we know in real life, do kind of present an idealized version of ourselves and like only the pretty stuff. Because like we have to, because everyone else does it, and it turns into this weird damaging like competition. Personally, I decided to stop doing that because I realized that it was hypocritical relative to like what I was preaching, which is to be unapologetically disabled in my case, which is incredibly hard for me to do. Like I don't want to be disabled, and I don't want that to be a part of my identity, but it is. And like, we have a lot of work to do as disabled people, and like, our allies have a lot of work to do with us. And so the day that I decided, it was somewhere around when I moved to Los Angeles and I started making a film about disability rights, and I decided that this was gonna be my career, so the day that I decided that I was going to be unapologetic about it, I had to stop being a hypocrite. So I had to show people, friends, family, whatever, on social media that like, it's not always rosy, and not just about my disability, because that would be weird if I just showed the non-rosy parts of my disability and not the rest of my life. And I think there's always this voice in the back of my head, like, I don't know if you had those people in 2007, like, or whenever you first got Facebook and you like vague booked something really depressing, like, fix is really sad. And you'd always have that person who like wrote your private message being like, you shouldn't put that because like, it draws attention to you or whatever. At least I had those people. And I still have that voice in my head. And that's why I try not to vague book. Like, when I feel like shit, I just tell people why I feel like shit. And a lot of the time I try and like pull something out of that. So it's not just like a waste of time for other people to read. But yeah, I feel like the day you, not necessarily figure out who you are, because like I said, you don't have to do that. But if there's a message that you're espousing at a time, and if that message has anything to do with being open and unapologetic, then like, do yourself a favor, I guess, and just like, try really hard, and I have not achieved this, but to not give a shit about like appearing perfect online, because no one is. And you know that when you're filtering that Instagram picture, which like, again, we all do, and that's not a bad thing, or when you're only saying, like when you're sitting in your room crying and you don't write about it on Facebook, but you like write about when you went to see Harry Potter and the Cursed Child, like, know that everyone else is going through those things, and that like, in my opinion, it makes you the stronger and braver and more public one to be like, hey, I feel like shit. And obviously do yourself a favor and like, be, you know, read your room when it comes to that. Don't become that person who like says everything all the time, because some of those things are not for your Facebook friends list, especially if you have like 1,000 Facebook friends. But yeah, I guess just like, be honest with yourself and with other people. If they've chosen to be your Facebook friend or follow you on Instagram, then like, they accept you in your three dimension. If they don't, then like, screw them and they can go away. Yeah? Yeah.
The community I referred to earlier, mm-hmm. in particular, you wouldn't have to talk to anyone in it to know. Everyone agrees we're all fundamentally broken.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
It's an empowering thing, and it's scary, but I think it's pretty important for the world.
Definitely. I think if you started off with this understanding of like, everyone is broken, and that's what comes from being a little bit more honest, even on those other platforms where usually people only show the rosy bits of their lives, like, then we're slowly working towards something like you've just described, where like, we've all seen a little bit of our brokennesses, and that allows for more happy and more sad, which, you know, more emotions are always a good thing, I think. Whoever wants to go next is basically the odds. Go for it.
I just wanted to talk about balance, which I would phrase maybe in terms of risk, where sometimes you're looking for a lower risk environment to try something new. I think there's a lot of value in that. And one of the ways I approach balance in that is to think about the risk in not trying those new things, in not exploring, in not sharing. It affects not only your ability to figure out who you are and what you want to do and what you want to participate in, but it also, if you don't share, it prevents other people from finding those things. It prevents you from finding solutions to problems. It prevents other people from seeing that their problems are shared and that there is help available. It prevents you from building new things that other people would like, from finding people who want to do things with you, who want to make changes in the world, who want to form new communities. And so I try to tell myself when I'm afraid of trying something new, when I'm afraid of sharing something about myself, of posting something that isn't the fun, happy life, that I want other people to know this, that I want the world to share this with me. And if the world doesn't like this, then maybe I'll reevaluate. Maybe I'll go do something else later. But there's a real risk, I think, in not sharing yourself, in not telling other people what's happening in your life, in not putting yourself out there. And if I put those both in the same category and talk about them both as risk, I find it much easier to try and find that balance by evaluating them on the same terms.
I agree. Do you want to respond?
Another thing, like right along with that, there's something else that I spend a lot of time on the internet that I came across, and it was about a girl who was running for Penn State on scholarship there, and she had a similar issue where everything looked so good on all her friends' social medias, and she actually ended up committing suicide her second semester of her freshman year. And if you look at her Instagram feed, it's all like beautiful, like she's gorgeous and was going out all the time and had all these perfect pictures with her friends. And her parents came out with her story about how she was so insecure, saying like, everyone looks like they're having so much fun, but I'm not. Mm-hmm. And so I was in a similar place, like in freshman year, I was like, this is not what I was supposed to be doing. Like,
right.
Everyone's having a great time. They have all these friends that they've met, and I don't. So seeing that was very helpful because it was like, well, she did that too, and I do that too. So like with the risk, it was like, well, if you looked at my Instagram, I look like I have fun all the time.
Right.
And that I'm not sitting here like sobbing, thinking that I am out of place. I don't have friends. Like they all are perfect. So with the risk, I was like, I should probably not do this because they probably aren't happy either. Like, if all of our things look perfect, I'm probably not the only one that is doing this. So that was helpful in like encouraging me to be more authentic, was because I feel like all of us, not just me, but like we owe it to other humans to say it's okay to not have like your highlight reel only shown.
That's a good way of putting it, highlight reel. I like that. You guys should seriously have like collaboratively written this with me. But yeah, no, I totally agree. And I think that if you have been that person who understands someone else's reality, just one other person, then you've done your job. Like I, up till maybe, yesterday, actually, I don't think there's a single picture of me on my Facebook with my crutches. Right, what does that say? I've literally been disabled for 25 years. Like, I haven't had Facebook for 25 years, but like, it was a very purposeful thing. And most people on my Facebook know I'm disabled, so like, who am I fooling? I'm not trying to not be me, but like, I am not comfortable with that. But putting that out there and, you know, doing things like this and using my voice, I now have a couple of people every so often who come to me and say, I really identified with what you said, and as a disabled person or as an insert whatever here person who was worried about portraying a certain aspect of myself in real life or online, you've really given me the strength to speak out. And I feel like if you can be that person that that girl was for you, it's so, so devastating that things had to end the way they did for her. But you now know that. You now know that your truth of not thinking that college was what you thought it was going to be is going to be important to that freshman who enters next year or in 3 years and is really not having a good time and looking at everyone else's Instagrams being like, the snow is so beautiful, but I'm also crying. And yeah, just be that person, and like, it's always worth it, even if it's scary. And it's still scary for me, and it will be for always. Yeah.
So not so much a question, but more of a exploration of intersectionality, which sounds really weird. So I'm a father of a daughter with a disability due to a birth injury. I'm an internet kid, raising an internet kid.
Good.
So she's a big part of, you know, obviously she's a big part of my in real life life. She's also a big part of my online life. Sharing moments with her, sharing experiences with her, and pictures of her and videos of her. And as someone who's, for the last 7 years, tried to figure out how to navigate as an advocate for someone who's disabled. Mm-hmm. Trying to come up with a way, and she's seven, so she doesn't have an Instagram account yet.
It won't be long.
Yeah. but knowing what I know and learning what I've learned in my experience as a human on the internet, and trying, you know, thinking 3, 4, 5 years ahead of how to prepare her for being an online person, you know, and not curating, you know, oh, this is my life and I'm ignoring a portion of it that's part of my daily.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's kind of what drew me to this session in particular was that intersectionality and trying to make sure that I'm being the best advocate that I can for someone who's disabled, and train her to be her own advocate, but also to remain authentic and to become the person that she, you know, the person that she wants to be, the person that she's going to be.
Yeah.
So it's an odd position.
Right.
For someone that's kind of on the outside looking in.
Mm-hmm.
And just was curious of how you've sort of, you know, obviously curated a little bit. You know, the title, the Museum of You, it's kind of interesting because we're all going to museums and there's a permanent collection and there's the traveling exhibit.
Exactly, yeah, thanks for getting it.
And we're always sort of curating. But any advice for, again, someone on the outside?
Well,
trying to be that advocate and trying to steer someone in that right direction of this is how you can express yourself and this is
right.
These are some of the best ways to do that.
Yeah. Well, first of all, thank you so much for coming. It's so interesting to have your perspective. And also, I would just like to say that since you're thinking about this and we're having this conversation, you are doing something right for your daughter. So thank you very much for that. She's lucky to have you. I would say that's an interesting answer because my parents were super not internet kids because I was born in 92. They didn't really know how to lead me through that and they didn't know, I don't think, that I was going to become an internet kid. But I think let her go through what will inevitably be phasic. So I'm sure that she will go through a phase where she kind of wants to have that more curated life where it's like, I'm not so ready to show what is, yes, an integral part of my daily, but also something that takes some accepting and some learning about. And so, yeah, I think just no forcing. And I think inevitably she will come to a community or a space on the internet that will allow her to do that. I didn't know that it was going to be this Facebook group, but that's what it was for me and that's what it turned into. And you being an internet kid might be able to at least lead her towards some things. So while she's still young and like not so much on the internet yet as an active presence herself, maybe like work to curate some of those voices that may not be exactly hers because she's the only one that can fill that hole. And maybe she will, which is exciting too. But curate some of those voices that may be slightly near to what she's experiencing. And it took a lot of work to find those voices for me. And that's part of the reason why I decided to become one, which is super not what I was made to do. Like, but I was like, you know, if I can't find it, then I will be it. And she will definitely have that attitude since you're asking this question. But they do exist. And there are great people out there. And I think just if you're going to do any leading, lead her towards the kind of communities and also just follow her lead in terms of what she wants to show and when. You know, often it becomes easier to show that stuff when you're older. And for me, quite a lot older, like I was 20, because, you know, you are you take less shit from people, I guess, and you more understand that people are going to be mean sometimes, but that's worth it for the people who come to you and say, you changed the way I think about X. For me, any hate is worth that. And I get it, like I get hate, but you do get to a point where that makes sense to you. So yeah, I think just I don't know, like start building now. It's never too early, and she'll have a home when she wants it. Yeah, go ahead. Oh my gosh, so many questions. Guys, we have 10 minutes left, but yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
And the best way for me, at least, was to sort of do it in baby steps by using things like privacy filters, having one filter that's, you know, for all your friends, there's a public filter, then there's a filter for all your friends and family on Facebook, and then there's just the people who you know are close enough, you know, you feel comfortable having them see the, I had a really terrible day today, I'm feeling really sad. And then you can sort of, as you get more comfortable with being yourself on the internet, expanding who is in that group. Or if you don't feel comfortable necessarily with the people on your Facebook, maybe having a different social media platform, which you have that kind of connection with. Like you have a Tumblr that has that, or a Twitter, so you keep those sort of separate, and then you can slowly sort of merge those two together as you get more comfortable being out there and being authentic.
I totally agree, and that's exactly what I meant when I said that you have the freedom to control what people see and when, and you can take strength from that, and that's not something that people should complain at you over. I think we have time for one more short question or comment. You go ahead. Huh? Oh, do I have a YouTube channel? Yes, I do, but I will tell you at the end. Yes, go ahead.
Short question from maybe the only person in the room. Do you have an offline archive of yourself that you keep literally to yourself, like a journal or something?
I did. I did keep a journal my entire first year of college, and then I stopped because I never finished things. No, mostly because I really wanted to do it handwritten, but my brain works way faster than my hand, and it was frustrating me. And I could just type it, but like excuses and stuff. No, I mean like not really relative to my online archive, which I guess is like the world that we live in now, and that's okay. I did have a private blog for a while, which I guess kind of works the same way, but I don't have that anymore because someone found it and I freaked out. But I think that a lot of kids have like use the internet now as their archive, and it's interesting. You can private things and unprivate things, as the last person was saying, and so you can show that as evidence of your growth whenever you're ready to, and also go back to things and be like, hey, I said this, but this is how I feel now. But yeah, maybe I'll start journaling again one day. That would be fun. And also, I have a BookTube channel, so if you guys like books, I am bilingual bookworm on BookTube. And yeah, I have a lot of fun over there, and I get really, really, really excited about books. Like, I am the definition of unapologetic excitement about books. It's kind of ridiculous. But yeah, if that's just like an aside, because my husband was being obnoxious. But thank you so much, you all. Like, I really, really was not expecting this. And we've just had the most amazing discussion. And it's the best ever start to NerdCon for me, and hopefully for you too. I really hope you feel like you've had a good time. And I will see all of you around over the next 2 days. And if you have any questions, this is the space in this convention center over the next 2 days where you can literally come up to me and like pretend that you've known known me for years, like even you who like struggle with that notion, but we are all friends here, and like please feel free to come up and I will probably ask you questions too. Thank you so much.